Man is here, yo. Crack open that Raz energy drink. Get ready for some raw, uncut sports talk. With Mike and Mike. Andy Dawson cut. NASCAR is such a race. Dennis Rodman can lock down LBJ. Who knows? We gotta ask one question.
Are you ready for it? Are you ready for it?
And what is up, guys? This is Michael Buckhouse with Just for Clicks. I am with my man over here, Mike, my co-host. Mike, how is your day today?
Man, it's a busy day. Busy day in sports today.
It is never busy a bad day when it's busy day in sports.
Never a bad day. Never a bad day. How was your day?
Hey, my day was a clusterfuck beyond clusterfucks, but I figured out that I'm officially old today, man.
How did you figure out you're old today?
Please enlighten me. So I was looking at my beard, and my wife loves my beard. I'm starting to get some grays in there, but I was looking to the left. I got this 3-inch hair in my ear, sticking straight out. I'm like, oh, that's like dog hair. So there's no way. I pulled on it. That thing is like balls deep in my ear, man. I'm like, what is going on with this? There is no way I am this freaking old, man. Like, there's no freaking way,
man. So I realized I was old this year. I've never had gray hair before. I've never, like, in my beard or my hair. Like January, I started just going through my hair, and then I found a whole shit ton of grays. And I started looking at my hair, like, oh man, it's all downhill from here.
Yeah, I got a couple in my side beard there, and like in my hair, my little hair that I do have. People always make fun of me because I'm bald. Like, people, I've been bald since I was 16. I've had this widow peak since I was 16. It's nothing new. So get over yourselves with that crap. But Mike, as you alluded to, we did have a big day in sports, and let's go ahead and get starting with the trending topics.
Let's go. Roll it.
Trending topics number one is the biggest news that I guess I was really not expecting, but Andy Dalton has officially been cut by the Cincinnati Bengals. He had $17.7 million left on his contract, 1 year left on his contract throughout the 2020 season. I thought that the Bengals were going to keep Andy Dalton, let him groom Big Joe over there, and 2021 would be Joe's season, not 2020.
Really?
Like,
really?
Yeah, really.
Really thought.
I mean, any logical person would keep a veteran quarterback. Well, Andy Dalton's been in the league since 2010 or 2011. I mean, that's 9-10 years under his belt. Why not have a veteran quarterback to teach somebody new?
I mean, it's Joe Burrow, number one draft pick. You're not going to draft someone the first pick of the draft and have them sit. Come on. We know this. It's historically, like, if you get drafted number one, you are expected to start day one.
You are expected to start on a shitty team. Cincinnati Bengals is not a horrible team. They just had a slew of bad injuries last year. Like, AJ Green was out the whole season. They had their the linebacker got suspended for kicking or spitting somebody or whatever he did. Finally, Bursett, or I don't even remember his name.
I'm gonna go even further.
Go ahead.
I'm gonna say Joe Burrow is a better quarterback than Andy Dalton.
Joe, you might be 100% correct there. But there's a big difference between high school and college, and college to the NFL. Look at the talent that Joe Burrow was playing with at LSU. Top of the line, all 5-star recruits playing against 3, 4, 2 stars. Right? Everybody in the NFL is a 5-star. Everybody.
No, you're absolutely right. But look who he's going to be throwing to. He's going to be throwing AJ Green.
Right.
And I hate
that doesn't want to be there anymore either, by the way.
Yeah, but could it be different now that he has Joe Burrow?
Are you saying Andy Dalton is like a cancer in the locker room?
I wouldn't say necessarily he's a cancer in the locker room, but if you go back and look at last season, there are a lot of passes that just weren't right there for AJ Green. He was overthrown quite a few times, or you know, Andy Dalton would leave him over the middle. You know, if, you know, the prima donna receivers don't want to be left over the middle because
you're right. Nobody does.
You're gonna end my career doing something like that, right? So, and watching Joe Burrow in college, he throws a pretty, pretty ball. He throws a pretty ball. His mechanics remind me a lot of Peyton Manning.
I agree with that 100%. Yes, you are 100% correct on that.
His pocket presence, it reminds me, it's Manning-esque. It really is. I think Joe Burrow is going to come into the league, and I think Joe Burrow is going in within 2 to 3 years. I think he'll take the number one quarterback spot in the league over Patrick Mahomes.
That is a bold statement. If you guys are just joining us here, the breaking news, I guess really not breaking now, but Andy Dalton has officially been cut by the Cincinnati Bengals. And the reason why I was not expecting this is because I thought Cincinnati was going to use Andy Dalton as some trade bait. I mean, why do you cut a quarterback that has been in the league for 9 or 10 years? I think he came in the league in 2010, if I'm not mistaken on that, from TCU, right? But either way, there are 3 or 4 teams out there that need a solid veteran quarterback. The Patriots come to mind. The Chargers come to mind. How about Jacksonville Jaguars? They come to mind. Who else? Maybe, I don't know. Maybe the Detroit Lions even. I mean, yes, I know they got Matthew Stafford, but maybe he's wore out his welcome there. Maybe a change of scenery would be good for Matthew Stafford as well. But regardless, I don't think you cut a starting quarterback with. I mean, I don't care if you get a sixth or seventh round pick. It's still a sixth or seventh round pick. Where did Tom Brady come from?
The sixth round.
Exactly. you can answer.
You know, I cannot wait. We'll talk about Tom Brady a little later. Let's talk about Tom Brady after the break. Yeah. We'll go to Tom Brady.
All right. So moving on.
So, Dennis Rodman, Dak Prescott, Quincy Carter posted today that he thinks Dak is a better quarterback than Aaron Rodgers based on stats. I understand he's a Cowboys fan because he was a Cowboys quarterback, but come on, man. Roger, he's better than Rodgers. Okay, statistically over the past couple of years, yes. Who did Aaron Rodgers have to throw to last year?
Last year? I don't remember anybody off the top of my head last year.
Where did they go in the playoffs?
They did go to the NFC Championship game, yes.
Thank you. Okay, so you're telling me Dak Prescott is better than Aaron Rodgers when Aaron Rodgers puts the team on his back and carries them into the playoffs, where Dak Prescott needs all these weapons around him. Dak Prescott wasn't a great passer until who showed up?
Amari Cooper, maybe?
Yeah. Once Amari Cooper showed up, which is, we talked about yesterday, I consider an elite receiver, then boom, now Dak Prescott is gaining all these stats. There's no way in hell Dak Prescott is a better quarterback than Aaron Rodgers or Tom Brady.
Well, let me try to defend Quincy Carter here a little bit. I know he's your boy and like whatnot, but looking at the stats here, let's just go to 2019. Aaron Rodgers had 62% completion rating for 4,000 yards, 26 touchdowns, 4 interceptions for a QBR rating of 94.5. Dak Prescott last year, 65% completion rate, 4,902 yards, 30 touchdowns, 11 interceptions for a QB rating of 99.7. So last year, statistically, Dak Prescott was better than Aaron Rodgers. 2018, Dak Prescott, 68% completion rating, a little under 4,000 yards, 22 touchdowns, 8 interceptions, ranking of 96.9 QBR rating. Aaron Rodgers, 62% completion rating, 4,400 yards, 25 touchdowns, 2 interceptions, 97. So Aaron Rodgers better in 2018. But I like to judge players by the eye test. Numbers can be condescending here. Kind of like the fog in the mist. You don't really know what's out there. Take, for example, Jameis Winston's. Oh, he threw for 5,000 yards, 30 touchdowns. Okay, let's look at the 30 interceptions. Let's look at the fact that he flat out sucked balls. I don't care if you threw for 5,000 yards, 30 touchdowns. How many games did your team win, right? Exactly. How many games did the Tampa Bay Buccaneers last year? 3, 4, whatever. Yeah. Horrible, see, right?
Hold on. I think Quincy is listening to us. Quincy, I know you said it's not up for it's not up for debate, but come on, man. Dak Prescott is not a better quarterback than Aaron Rodgers, brother.
Yeah, I mean, I actually was in a debate earlier tonight, like who is better, Brett Favre or Aaron Rodgers. I said Aaron Rodgers because of Brett Favre's interception habit that he had in the big time moments. He would try to force balls down the field. Aaron Rodgers could force balls down the field and complete those passes with mediocre receivers. Who was the best receiver that Aaron Rodgers has probably played with? Jordy Nelson, probably one of the best.
Devontae Adams.
Okay, yeah.
Randall Cobb was good in his prime.
He was, yes. Look who Dak Prescott is thrown to right now. You said he has not become a complete passer since Amari Cooper came onto the field. He has potentially three receivers on his team coming up.
Before you say a complete passer, you have to understand that a lot of Dak Prescott's yards came from Amari Cooper's yard after completion, right? That's where a lot of those yards came from. Because once if Amari Cooper gets open and gets and breaks a couple tackles, he's gone. He's a home runner, right? But on Aaron Rodgers can actually push the ball down the field, right? Dak, he's got the nickname Dink and Dunk Dak because he throws these 5-10 yard passes.
Right.
And the receivers break, and that's what gets Dak all these yards. Not because Dak is throwing the ball down the field, you know, 30, 40, 50 yards. No, it's not. That's not what's happening. And that's why I steal Jerry Jones, if you're listening, we need to get rid of Dak Prescott. Let's go get another quarterback.
Let's go get Cam Newton, right? Or yeah. How about Andy Dalton? Would Andy Dalton fit perfect in a Cowboys system?
I think a lot of quarterbacks would fit perfect in the Cowboys system. Like we talked about last night, they have a top five line with their draft this year. I think they easily have a top seven, top eight defense. And then they have Ezekiel Elliott. You give any quarterback a running game, they're automatically set up for success.
Right. So, I've been kind of passively looking through these stats here. Dak is entering to his fifth season, and I guess you can say he is consistently getting better, but so are the interceptions. They're going up as well. His first season, he had 4 interceptions. His second season, when Zeke was suspended for those 4 games, he threw for 13 interceptions. 2018, he threw for 8, and last year he threw for 11. There's two seasons, 2010 and 2008, that Aaron Rodgers threw for double digits interceptions. That's 11 and 13. Also on those seasons, he had a QBR ranking over 100. So I'm not for sure what stats old Quincy Carter is looking at here, but Aaron Rodgers threw over for 4,000 yards, 2019, 2018, 2017. He still threw for 1,700 yards and he had that broken collarbone. He missed, was it 10 games or 11 games? I think it was. And he is consistently 3,800 yards plus when healthy.
Yeah.
Aaron
Rodgers is arguably the most underrated quarterback in the league. And he's arguably one of the most underrated, greatest quarterbacks of all time.
You're saying Aaron Rodgers is underrated. I classify him as the GOAT. I think he's better than Tom Brady.
Yeah, no, 100%. But what I'm saying is Aaron Rodgers doesn't get the credit like Tom Brady, Peyton Manning, Drew Brees, Troy Aikman, Steve Young, Dan Marino. Like, he doesn't get that recognition like those quarterbacks do. And I think, in my opinion, I would take Aaron Rodgers over any of those quarterbacks with the exception of Peyton Manning.
Yeah, even at 36 years of age, I would still take Aaron Rodgers over Dak Prescott.
And I
have to bring this comment up here. Jameis, our guest from last night, saying that Jameis Winston will be better player after his LASIK eye surgery and coaching from Breeze and Coach Sean Payton. Do you agree with that? Are you saying his 30 interceptions was because he was blind, couldn't see 10 yards down the field?
I don't think they let him on the field if he doesn't pass an eye test. I think Jameis Winston is a bust. I've always thought he was a bust, and I don't think any amount of coaching is going to coach him up to be I don't think Jameis Winston will be a starter again in the NFL.
I agree with that. He is going to be a solid backup quarterback for just like what Teddy Bridgewater was for the Saints last year when Drew Brees went down for those 4 weeks. He came in and, you know, he did not let them go 0-4. He actually played really, really well. But as far as Jameis learning from Drew Brees and Sean Payton, he could have done better in Tampa Bay. You have probably the second greatest quarterback ever in Tom Brady there and a quarterback guru in Bruce Arians. If you were going to go there to, quote, learn and become a better player, you would have stayed in Tampa Bay. Yeah, Tampa Bay is the place to be.
Yeah, but look at Winston's season last year. It was horrible.
So Jameson did bring up that they did go 7-9. I guess I missed a couple games that he only threw three interceptions and instead of the four. But Jameis Winston will never start another NFL game in his career after this year.
Mike Reeves, I hear what you're saying, but look at the look at the receivers he had to throw to. A lot of people forget that these receivers make up for these quarterbacks' yards.
If you have Mike Evans on your team and you don't throw for at least 3,500 yards, you are horrible.
Horrible quarterback. Mike Evans is a monster.
So, yeah. So, moving on here, guys. We are going to move on to number three.
That's NASCAR.
I must have been smoking that day or something. But guys, we alluded to the COVID-19 last night. If I get those words out right now, that we're kind of thinking it was blown out of proportion and like whatnot. And I think NASCAR is kind of on that same boat now as they are set to start their racing season May 7th. Yes, they don't have any fans. Yes, they're not in close contact or whatever, unless they're fighting after the race. But this is positive for me because I have been hearing rumors. I've been reading that people are kind of writing off all summer sports and even the NFL season. But having NASCAR start up next Sunday or Saturday, whenever they officially do race, this is positive for baseball. Mike alluded to last night that baseball is set to start July 4th, America's pastime on America's Day. Mike, you know, I'm taking the words right out of your mouth there, but this is positive for us NFL fans. I mean, training camp is kind of overrated anyways. I coach high school balls, and my kids are more hungry now than they were last year because we aren't drilling them four hours a day in this off-season program stuff. So NASCAR is set to start up next Sunday. Pretty positive thoughts that maybe the COVID thing was kind of blown out of proportion.
So I never watched NASCAR, like ever. Never watch NASCAR, but I promise you on May 7th, I will be watching NASCAR because it is some kind of sports. We haven't had sports all year, and I am itching like a dope fiend to see some kind of competition. So I'm excited, and I think it is a precursor of good things to come for the sports world.
Let me tell you something, Mike. I was never a really big NASCAR fan by any means. Like I got, like I'm not a diehard. Like I don't have, you know, 16 Coors Light cases of beer sitting at my house Sunday afternoon or like anything. But you have to go to a NASCAR race in person. You have to go. my dad took me back when I was like 23 or 24 years old. And I was like, oh, this is going to be stupid. They're turning left. I don't have anybody talking in my ear. Tell me what is going on. First of all, you can bring in a cooler of beer. You can bring a 12x12 cooler. You can bring it in. You can bring in snacks. I had my jacket full of alcohol. I had my cooler. I was sitting like eighth row up on first turn at the Kansas Speedway. The first time those cars came by, it blew me back in my seat, or like I was standing up. It blew me back. It blew off my hat. And I was like, hell yeah, I'm having a grand time. So yeah,
I know what you mean. So where I live, I live on the outskirts of Austin in Kyle. And we have Kyle Raceway, and we go to those races. Those are pretty cool.
Yeah,
I like to go there and get drunk.
Just going to races in general in person is fun. I mean, I'm not an avid NASCAR fan by any means. I'm not gonna. I'm probably gonna tune in on Sunday because you know, just like you said, there's gonna be nothing else on. But like Jameis said, kind of what I alluded to here, this is positive for the sports world moving forward. I think the world's going to come back to normal once we realize, hey, it's not that bad. Let's be totally honest. Yeah.
I mean, so, you know, like we talked about last night, Mike Pence was going through the Mayo Clinic without a mask on.
Without hey, and looks like we got a host from Twist that wants to join it in the show. Should we bring on Mike Reeves?
I think we should bring on Mike Reeves.
Let's go ahead and bring on Mike Reeves.
He called me a closet Green Bay fan.
Hey, those are your words, not ours.
They are. I am a closet Packers fan. What's going on, Mike?
What to do, fellas?
If you can go ahead and mute your computer, that'd be fantastic, man. So you want to come on. I feel like you want to talk smack to the Green Bay fans since Mike is a Falcons fan, a Vikings fan. You should be a Falcons fan. They both suck. But regardless, go ahead, Mike.
I love the new banter, by the way, with your new host who's a Cowboys fan but wears Aaron Rodgers jerseys underneath his Dak Prescott sweatshirt. Also likes to, take car selfies. So I did work on that new logo for you guys.
much appreciated there.
No, so go ahead. I was just, obviously watching and, the stuff you're throwing out there is just ludicrous. I mean, Joe Burrow's going to be better than Patty Mahomes?
Yeah.
No. He didn't say that. He said better than Andy Dalton.
No. He'll be – Joe Burrow in 3 years in the league will be a better quarterback than Patty Mahomes.
What smoke is coming out of that thing that you're using?
Man, it's called realism.
Yeah.
Patty Mahomes, realism. We might never see a quarterback like him again. And to think
except for Joe Burrow.
I'm telling you, Joe, did you watch him play last season?
He had the best statistical season out of any college quarterback, but he's also 24 years old. That wasn't his first year in college.
Man, I'm telling you right now, his pocket presence and his pocket awareness is probably the best I've seen coming out of college in a very, very long time.
You're right, but it doesn't necessarily translate to the NFL. That's what Pat Mahomes has proved.
I do agree with that.
I would agree with you.
And with the Super Bowl ring.
College at Texas Tech was a okay quarterback. He was okay. And he got to the league, but how much of that is – how much of his progression, how much credit is given to Andy Reid for that? I mean, we're talking about Andy Reid, who developed McNabb. You know what I mean? Like, when McNabb came from Syracuse, he was an okay quarterback at Syracuse, too. But when he came into the league under Andy Reid, wow. Like, it was a big step. And that's the same thing that I think that happened with Patrick Mahomes. Joe Burrow is a pure talent quarterback that – once he gets into the NFL and he starts getting coached up, holy shit, it's going to be lights out.
How many Super Bowls did Andy Reid have before Pat Mahomes was his quarterback?
None.
He had none. And how many years did it take Pat Mahomes to win a Super Bowl?
Three. Two.
Two. In his second full year, wasn't it, Mike?
Yeah, 2 years as a starter, yes. because he did play one game as a rookie, filled in for Alex Smith the last game of the season versus Denver Broncos, and he threw for like 350 some yards. But
I mean, he's already got as many as your boy Aaron Rodgers. And he's the same age as Burrow, if not younger. That's my point. I mean, they came out and said Jordan Love can sit on the bench for 3 years, and by the time he has a chance to start, he'll be the same age as Burrow. So I'll come back on the show in a year once Joe Burrow's actually played some football. I mean, you just – to compare him to Pat Mahomes, Mike. Woo!
Yeah.
Yeah.
I compared Joe Burrow to Peyton Manning.
Mechanics like Peyton Manning. He has
mechanics like Peyton Manning. I'm telling you, watch.
But okay. I do have to agree with Mike from Twist there. If you guys have not checked out Twist, check them out. They're live Saturday afternoons at noon East Coast time, right, Mike?
Right.
If I'm mistaken. Right. So I'm not saying that Joe Burrow is going to be Patrick Mahomes, because I think Patrick Mahomes is a once-in-a-lifetime talent that we are seeing, just the way he elevates the Kansas City Chiefs play here. But to make those claims that Joe Burrow is going to be I'm not going to dispute that he might be a top tier quarterback in the league moving forward, but to say that before they've even done training camp, before he's even had a chance to get popped in the mouth by a linebacker, I mean, come on now.
I'm telling you.
I hope to see it. I mean, your boy Rodgers is going to be wearing purple here in about 2 years on the redemption tour for the
Vikings.
I don't think he goes to the Vikings. He's going to go to the Patriots. I only think Aaron Rodgers plays one more year with the Packers.
I agree with that.
I would agree. Yeah.
I think he's going to go to San Diego, or he'll go to the Pats.
So, Mike.
The Colts.
So the three mics should make a right turn here. But before I let you go, Mike from Twist here, look at this comment that Jameis threw in at us here. I'm sorry, wrong one here. It says that Joe Burrow and Tua will be massive disappointments, a.k.a. bust in the NFL.
That's ludicrous.
Tua, I could see, because he is being thrown into a rebuilding process, and I think the pressure on Tua to perform and get to the playoffs this season is going to be so high that I'm not for sure if he can handle that. Joe Burrow, Cincinnati understands that, hey, we suck. We've sucked for 50 plus years, you know, even when Boomer Esiason like was there and they went to the playoffs, they kind of slipped in there. So Cincinnati is used to going 7-9 year in and year out. And so if Joe Burrow gets them to even six wins, it will be a success for Cincinnati and Joe Burrow, giving him confidence moving forward, I think. But Tua might be a bust.
Nah, I don't think Tua is going to be a bust. I think Tua is going to be a good quarterback too. I think they win the division.
Mike, any thoughts on that?
It's not a rebuilding team. They're rebuilt. It was all for this year. I mean, they came in swinging at free agency, and, you know, we'll have to see if they hit on those picks or not. But, you know, getting offensive tackle right away for him and building around him. And he's not playing this year unless the beard gets hurt. I mean, the plan is not for him to come in and play. He's healthy enough to play. He's fine. But that's not their plan. Their plan is next year.
I disagree. I think he starts week one over the beard. I really do.
I'll put $50 on it.
I agree with Mike from Twist the beard does start.
You just don't draft a quarterback that high unless you are prepared for them to start week one.
You heard it here. I got a Venmo, so after week one, I'll be finding you $50.
All right, Mike. Thank you for joining us. Stay, and we'll catch you next time here. So guys, that was Mike from Twist. If you guys are interested in jumping out on the show and bantering with us a little bit throughout the night, there is a link there, first link in the comment. Just click on that link and we'll feel free to be ready with your comment or question, because any dead air, I'm kicking you out. We don't have time for that crap over here. Especially, I mean, Mike, I wasn't going to call you out on that, but Joe Burrow over Peyton or over Patty Mahomes.
Yeah.
That's tough. That's tough.
I'm telling you.
Wow. Let me ask you this question. The Kansas City Chiefs the last two seasons, arguably the best team in the NFL. They would have won back-to-back Super Bowls now if Dee Ford wasn't lined off sides. Is the Kansas City Chiefs the Kansas City Chiefs that we know the last two seasons without Patrick Mahomes?
It depends on who you put in there as quarterback.
Joe Burrow.
Yeah, I think so.
You think with that suspect offensive line that Joe Burrow can flee the pocket like Patrick Mahomes' hands, look to the left, throw right because he knows Tyreek Hill is running 66 yards down the field wide open.
Tyreek Hill. I'm just going to throw the ball to Tyreek Hill. Yeah.
But you don't see him. You just know he's there because of the game awareness. Like he has the football IQ. I mean, football IQ is so overrated. Like he just has plain. He can ball because he just has the smarts of the game. It's simple. Yeah. Simple as that.
I think Joe Burrow has those smarts too. I don't think Joe Burrow is a scrambling quarterback like Patrick Mahomes. And that's what makes Mahomes so dangerous with the no-look passes and everything like that. Right, but Joe Burrow has better pocket awareness and better pocket presence than Patrick Mahomes, 100%.
Okay, so now living in the Indiana, Cincinnati area, like we all kind of live in that tri-state area, I get a lot of Cincinnati Bengals games. So I'm going to get the chance to watch Joe Burrow a lot this season. So I hope for your sake you are right, because if you're not and Joe Burrow's a bust, I'm going to blast you every day for the next 3 years. All right, guys. So let's go ahead and move on.
All right, man. Topic number 4. Rodman came out and said in his prime he would be able to lock down King James. What do you think? I'll go after you. What do you think?
It depends on what era they're playing in. Like, so both players are in their time. Mm-hmm. If they're playing in today's NBA, Rodman's defense of skill set would not be that effective because his was basically straight. I mean, yes, he was a great rebounder, block shots, very aggressive, good footwork. But what put him over the edge of most players was the pure fear of, like, I don't know if I'm going to get punched in the gut or if he will go up for a block shot. So back when he played in the 90s and late 80s, that was fine. But in today's NBA, he would get a intentional two or whatever, or a flagrant two. Yeah. He'd be ejected for three or four games. So in a 7-game series, he might play 2 games. Therefore, LeBron James would get the best of the team. I'm not saying he is not an excellent defender. I'm saying back in his day, that was legal. Now, if they were playing in the 90s, when this was all, you know, the bad boy Pistons and, hey, I'm going to fight you. I don't care. I'm not. I might get a technical foul, cool, but I'm not going to get ejected. I think it would take LeBron James a year or two to adapt to that game. So, first couple years, I think Rodman would have the better of LeBron James, but year 3, 4, 5, I think LeBron James will still handle him just because he's so big, he's so powerful that he can be getting punched in the gut. He's that 6-pack rock of abs is going to break Dennis Rodman's hands, even if it is Taco Tuesday.
No. in today's game, I disagree with Rodman's statement. But if LeBron played in the 90s in that era, no, LeBron James, no. Because, I mean, think about who Rodman locked down. I mean, we're talking about like Magic Johnson. We're talking about like.
He did lock down Scottie Pippen too.
Scottie Pippen, Michael Jordan, like, you know, he locked down some of the greatest basketball players that stepped on the court. You know what I mean?
You said some of the greatest, but he can't lock down the greatest in LeBron James.
In that era, if LeBron was playing in the 90s, 100%. Rodman locking him down. Yeah.
What about in 2015?
2015, no, because the league went soft, just like with all sports, just like even with football. Football's going soft, right? You can't say, like, do you think it would be like comparing, like, do you think Patrick Mahomes would be able to play in the 90s? Do you think Patrick Mahomes is the quarterback he is today in the 90s? No. Even in the '80s, no,
he would still be effective and be good, but yeah. You would not see him rolling out of the pocket as much because there's a linebacker coming to take his head off.
Exactly. I mean, it's hard to. That's why it's hard to debate these players from different eras because just the way the games were played back then.
Yeah.
That's why I still say LeBron. I mean, that's why I still say Michael Jordan is better than LeBron James.
Yeah. Well. I don't know per se because I didn't really start watching basketball till Michael Jordan was kind of past his prime. I'd say like 98, 99, like that 97 season is kind of when I got intrigued by basketball. And you can say Michael Jordan's kind of over the hill at that point somewhat. Yeah. Yes, he was still very, very talented. Don't get me wrong. But 92, 93, Michael Jordan was a lot better than 97, 98, Michael Jordan. So with that being said, I don't think Michael Jordan would be able to survive in today's NBA because
I do his work ethic, bro. Well, Michael Jordan's work ethic is like, have you seen The Last Dance? Have you seen any of it?
Yes. I'm up to episode 4. So yeah,
his work ethic is there's nobody in sports that can match his work ethic.
I'm not disputing that one bit.
So, and that's why I still think like if Michael Jordan played in today's game, I think Michael Jordan is better today if he was in his prime today than he was back then, right? Because the league was, like you said earlier, you get punched in the gut or you would get roughed up. You know what I mean? Today's game, Michael Jordan would, man.
Well, you were referring to The Last Dance, and clearly we don't know what happened, you know, because like I was a little kid from 91 to 98 or like, you know, when that prime Bulls thing happened. But in The Last Dance documentary, he said he didn't even start to lift weights till 93 because he got tired of getting beat up by Dennis Rodman and the Bad Boy Pistons. With the weaker NBA this season, you wouldn't, quote, be getting beat up the way he was getting beat up. So I don't think he would not be as big. He wouldn't be as strong or be as fast because he wouldn't touch a weight because he didn't have to because he wouldn't be getting beat up.
Right. So, the way he studies the game and the way he goes about the game, like there's no question. Yeah. I would agree with that, Jameson. Kobe and Jordan are similar players. Yeah. MJ's better, but you know, I don't call me crazy, but I don't even think LeBron James is a better basketball player than Kobe. I think Kobe is a better basketball player than LeBron James.
There is a difference between those three players. Kobe and Michael Jordan had a killer instinct. They wanted the ball in their hands. They had their foot on their neck. They wanted to crush it over and over and over. LeBron James doesn't quite have that killer instinct. He has always kind of had that right-hand man to bail him out in the end. Kobe was the man on his team in the 2010 championship, and we saw it. Like, he had that killer instinct. Yes, Michael Jordan had Scottie Pippen to bail him out, or Steve Kerr, or even the Grant guy. Can't think of his name.
Look how Jordan did when Pippen left. He was still a man. He didn't have a number two.
So, yeah.
Wow.
I'm going to.
Leonard is the GOAT. That's retarded. Kawhi Leonard is nowhere. Kawhi Leonard is not even in the same conversation as Kobe, LeBron, and Jordan. Not even in the same conversation.
I don't know. I mean, he doesn't have that killer instinct personality verbally, but if you watch his game, I mean, his game has transcended a lot over the last 3 years. You know,
it has, but look at Michael Jordan when he came in the league. Automatically baller,
right?
Kobe, automatic baller. LeBron, automatic baller. Kawhi Leonard took a little bit, and he was, I think Kawhi Leonard only elevated his play because of Pop
in San Antonio. Well, and I think he was kind of forced to take a back seat in San Antonio as well, because you did have Tim Duncan, you had Ginobili and Parker, and those guys. He was an unestablished player coming to an established team as a rookie. I think he was like a 15th or 16th round or pick as well. So, I mean, I think he did go in the lottery. I'm not for sure. I have to have Marcus the Sports Freak to verify that. But he didn't have to have that leadership or that killer mentality for the first 3 years of his career because that was already established in San Antonio.
That's true, but if you want to assert yourself or you want to be the best at anything you do. It doesn't matter if it's basketball, football, baseball, chess, checkers. It doesn't matter what it is. If you want to be the best, you have to have that killer instinct. Doesn't matter if, oh, you want me to take a back seat. No. I made it to the league for a reason, and I'm going to continue that reason. I don't give a shit about anything else.
Are you saying LeBron James isn't the best because he doesn't have that killer instinct?
Yeah. I don't think he has that killer instinct.
I don't think he does. Like, matter of fact, I know he doesn't, because even when the Heat, when he won the championships, like way at the Heat, he still wasn't the man per se. Like, he wasn't like, give me the ball.
He had wins with him. Yeah. If you look everywhere that LeBron has gone, he's had somebody that is a star on the team with him. You know what I mean? And Michael Jordan, yes, he had stars, but I think Michael Jordan made the people on his team, right?
Made them better.
He made them better. Just because, like, I was watching that Last Dance. Like, Michael was saying that I practice harder than I play in the game. That way, when things come in the game, it's just second nature. And watching The Last Dance and watching other documentaries about Michael Jordan, he's not wrong. He practices hard. So when he does, he elevates that whole team. You know what I mean? Because if, damn, I got to go against Jordan, I got to do it. You know what I mean? And or otherwise, Jordan's going to get on my ass. So they play hard in practice, too. And I think that's why Jordan is the best. I mean, there's no question Jordan is the GOAT.
Yeah, I would like to see some type of AI system made up, because there are computer nerds out there that are sports enthusiasts like as well. Take MJ, put him into a game. Take LeBron James, put him in a game. Put their best teams in the game and play them in the 93 season when, you know, the punching and gouging eyes was a thing, and then put them in the 2015 season just to see what happens. You know, like, I would be intrigued to see what happens.
I would too.
But let's go ahead and move on to our last topic of the night. As we alluded to in the very first part of the show, Andy Dalton was cut by the Cincinnati Bengals here, and we've kind of hinted out where we think he would land. But Mike, you have to answer this question first. Where do you think Andy Dalton lands in the 2020 season, if anywhere?
I don't know, man. Now that he's on the open market, I don't know. I think the Patriots or the Jaguars.
Yeah.
I think he looks really appealing to Bill Belichick.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more with that. Once Tom Brady left New England, I was on record. I put it on social media, whatever you want to say it. I said, why are the New England Patriots not talking to Cincinnati to get Andy Dalton right now? He would fit perfect into that system. He is 9 years into the league. He has not won anything, really. I mean, he had a bunch of 7-9 season, 8-8 seasons. Perfect matchup right there. Then you have, you know, yes, Chargers did draft a quarterback. They have Tyron Taylor there. Whatnot. I don't know what direction this the Los Angeles Chargers want to go as far as quarterback whatsoever goes. They are a duck on the pond. They are just out there floating. Yeah. We don't know what's going on below the surface whatsoever. Yeah. Jacksonville Jaguars would be a great landing spot as well. I don't think Garner Minshew is the answer in Jacksonville. It really raised my eyebrows when they let Nick Foles go after a season, after an injury plague season. He got hurt with the second play of the, or the second drive of the first game. So you didn't even get a chance there. But I think Andy Dalton does end up in New England. I don't think Bill Belichick is sold on their quarterback situation there whatsoever.
So let me ask you a question with that. Remember how earlier in the show I said we'll talk about Tom Brady, right?
Yeah.
If Andy Dalton goes to New England, right, and they start winning a slew of championships again, does that tarnish Tom Brady's career?
I don't think it. I mean, winning 6 Super Bowls alone will never tarnish your career. I don't care if you had the greatest coach in the world or the worst coach in the world. Coaches do not play the game. Okay, you have to throw the ball still.
Maybe not tarnish his record. But everybody says, oh, Tom Brady is the greatest quarterback ever. Right. He can go anywhere and play. So if Brady goes to Tampa Bay and is not the quarterback he is at the Patriots, and that's hard to say because Tom Brady is at the end of his career. So to say that is kind of it's kind of out there. But if Andy Dalton, late in his career, goes to New England under Belichick and they win, let's say over the next 5 years, they win 3 Super Bowls. Does that mean Tom Brady is nothing but a system quarterback?
I want to say yes, but that also makes Bill Belichick look that much better, like, as well, saying that he has a system that he can plug and play quarterbacks. But if you want to use that argument, we can look back at the year that Tom Brady tore his ACL when Matt Castle came in. Matt Castle had a very, very good season with the Patriots. I think I don't remember the record. I think went 9-7. I want to say barely missed the playoffs because I don't remember the facts off the top of my head. But Matt Castle had an amazing year, so much that the Kansas City Chiefs wanted to pay him a certain amount of money to come be a bust at Kansas City. Still
and
bitter.
The Cowboys. And
yeah. So, I mean, we can say that Tom Brady is a system quarterback whatsoever. I don't think that tarnishes his career whatsoever. He can go down to Tampa Bay, be 8-8, and people are still going to say, oh, he's 42 years old or 43 or how old he is. He's over the hill, yada yada yada. So, I to answer your question, I don't think it's going to tarnish his career whatsoever. The only thing it is going to do is make Bill Belichick look that much better and solidify him as the greatest coach ever.
I agree with that, but I think it just makes him a system quarterback. And no, not every quarter. Jameson, you say every quarterback has a system. Some are better than the others. I disagree with that. Prime example. Patty Mahomes can go to any team in the league next season and automatically make that team a contender. Drew Brees can go to any team in the league and make them a contender. Yeah, Aaron Rodgers, the same. Tom Brady, on the other hand, I think is a system quarterback. It's got to have a system in place.
Tom Brady is not going to win you a lot of games without some weapons around him. The reason why the Patriots were so good, because they had a core of players that were there consistently, and they weren't these big first round picks, mainstream stars, but they were fourth, fifth round picks that were there to work hard for 3 or 4 seasons and win a championship. And that's how they survived. I don't think Tom Brady could go. People were talking about him going to the Chargers. I don't think he could have went to Los Angeles and been Tom Brady.
No, I don't think he could have went in the prime of his career anywhere in the league and been as successful as he was in New England. Hands down. No way.
Yeah. So, I have to say that Tom Brady's career won't be tarnished by any means, because he still has six Super Bowl rings. Yeah.
Not tarnished, but it makes you look back on it and be like, well, was he?
Maybe he's not the GOAT, right?
Yeah. It means not the greatest.
Yeah. So, because I still think he is right now in the NFL. I think he's the third best quarterback in the NFL based off last year. I think Aaron Rodgers is better than him, and Patrick Mahomes is better than him. And really? If our boy Quincy Carter had a choice, Dak Prescott would be number 2, right? It would be Patrick Mahomes, Dak Prescott, and then Aaron Rodgers. So,
it's total horseshit.
So, guys, that is going to be it for today's show. As always, thanks for joining us. Join us Sunday night here on the Just for Clicks Facebook page, 9:30 East Coast time. You guys can catch this replay on rtfsportsnetwork.com at 12 p.m. East Coast time, full edited published version on there. So go ahead and check us out. So before we go, Jameis says we'll see coming up this year if Tom Brady sucks or a system quarterback. So
my money's on a system quarterback.
Yeah, I agree. But guys, we're out. Have a good night.
Have a good weekend. Later.
Always. Go Chiefs.